Welcome to the 2014 edition of the 90 Degree Show, hosted by the Marching Podcast and Blog Talk Radio. Advice may be misleading, but examples are always clear. And here's your host, the Phantom Podcaster himself, Joe Beard.
Welcome to the 90 Degree Show for tonight. I am your host, Joe Beard, and happy to be of service for you. Today is September 7th, 2014, 5 o'clock on the West Coast and 8 o'clock on the East Coast. We appreciate all those listening live and listening in podcast form, whether through Blog Talk Radio, our website, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, iTunes, or any other social media device that you have. At the end of the broadcast, if you decide you like the show, then we appreciate a donation to the network, if you feel so in your heart, of course. Just simply go to themarchingpodcast.com and click on the donate button to help improve the show and help build our scholarship fund. We are really excited to bring to you another show this season. Tonight, our featured matchup is Elizabeth City versus North Carolina Central. We also want to talk about Alabama A&amp and Tuskeegee. Now, excuse me, there are multiple great matchups every week, and we'll try our best to touch on all of them, but you yourself can help us by calling into the number you see there on your screen, 718-664-6025, and call us and school us on what we know or what you saw that weekend. Fill us in on your experience and the matchup that you see that we maybe did not see. Or you can fill us in and let us know and let all the listeners know what went down. Call in, correct us. If you disagree or if you agree or whatever you may feel, just please do so. And that's the show for the people. Just like science, we want to go through as much peer review as possible. Now, I did not see too much tape of our featured matchup this weekend for Elizabeth City and North Carolina Central, but we will talk about last week's discussions, MEAC SWAC, because the film is actually out. We'll touch a little bit on some other bands and some other matchups that have happened this year. So we're really, really excited again to bring you another show. So we'll give you the format for the show tonight. I'll be talking in the first segment about who won with our People's Choice Awards for this week. If you go to the website, marchpodcast.com, and vote on our featured matchup, I'll read out the winner. I'll bring in Rashad in our first segment, so we'll talk to him about our featured matchup, and the lines will be open to you at all segments to call in. The second segment, we'll talk about our second matchup, and in the last segment, we'll talk about any other bands, anything we've seen, potential barn burners for the upcoming season, and comments from the web. On Word on the Street, I read the comments that I saw from the 5th, Facebook, YouTube, or anything that I saw noteworthy this week. And again, all the segments are open for you to call in and speak. So that'll be really, really exciting, I am sure. Let's take the time for our first commercial break. You can email the show at marchingpodcast@gmail.com, tweet us at marchingpodcast, and follow our blog, blog4.themarchingpodcast.com. If you are listening live and have a Blog Talk Radio account, you can log into the chat room and leave your comments there. Last and definitely not least, please check out the website, themarchingpodcast.com. Let's take the time to hear from our beloved sponsors. Tonight's show is brought to you by Liquid Effects Photography, Block Band Music, Do Edge One Productions, Bandhead.org, and HBCUBands.com. Let's take the time to hear from them now.
This is Curtis from 80MinutesOfRegulation.com. From referee's whistle to drum major's whistle and back, your source for sports and marching and athletic music. You're listening to the 90 Degree Show on the Marching Podcast Network.
Having an anniversary party, birthday party, or better yet, are you about to marry that special someone? Liquid Effects Photography is the perfect choice to immortalize all your most special moments. With 10 years of dependable professional service that can deliver from the conventional to the best in cutting-edge technology and creativity, Come experience the uniqueness of Liquid Effects Photography. We serve the entire Upper Midwest and will travel further upon request. Come check us out at liquideffects.com. That's LIQUIDEFFEX.com. Or call us at 773-454-5556. That's 773-454-5556.
From photo shoots to graduation pictures, from pro base to band footage, from pageants to yard shows, there's only one team you can count on, the Edge One Productions. Visit theedgeone.com and trust me, you won't be disappointed.
Fan directors, have you ever found yourselves in this situation? Showtime is quickly approaching. Your budget is quickly disappearing. Your music choices are narrowing. The equipment condition is wearing and your stress level is mounting. Stop what you're doing and contact Block Band Music and find out how we've got you. Check www.blockbandmusic.com, providing music, equipment, gear, and accessories to show style, core style, and traditional bands worldwide.
Chopping It Up is a podcast of one-on-one interviews with positive role models that have a connection through music and or education. Chopping It Up is all about inspiring our youth for a great future and providing a roadmap on how to get there. We also chop it up to give insight to anyone looking for information or hope in their endeavors. Chop it up with us on Tuesday at 9 p.m. Eastern at blogtalkradio.com/marchingpodcast. Chopping It Up, changing the world through positive interaction.
What if there was a Facebook for bands? Wait a minute, there is. Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org is a social network for HBCU show bands. You can create your own profile and post videos, photos, and comments on Bandhead.org. Need somewhere to post events, audition schedules, job postings? Check out Bandhead.org. Are you recruiting for talent? Go to Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org, a social network for bands.
Hey, Bandheads, this is Christy Walker, alumni of the North Carolina A&T Blue and Gold Marching Machine and one of the creators of thefifthquarter.com, and you are listening to the 90 Degree Show on the Marching Podcast Network.
All right, we're back. That's a little bit of Alabama A&amp from this past weekend that you're listening to right now in the background. We're excited to kick off our first section here of the 90 Degree Show, and we like to thank our sponsors to help improve the show and help build our scholarship fund, and again, allows us to broadcast during these peak hours. All right, let's go ahead and get started, and let's read who the winner was from our last week's Marching Podcast People's Choice Awards. Let me go ahead and open up the website here so we can get to it. In the meantime, while we fade that out a little, I want to bring in our the owner and founder of the outstanding Block Band Music and Publishing, Mr. Rashard Waters. What's going on tonight, Rashard?
Man, I've got so many videos open right now, I can't even figure out which one to mute. I'm going back and forth. I'm like, I hear something playing, but I got four things open. I can't find it.
I know, man. It's that time of year. I know this week, you know, I had a full slate of stuff to watch. I had a real nice time getting away from work and everything. So I was like, hey, man, it's that time of year again. So really excited to have you on. I'm sure that you checked out some really good, exciting matchups for this week. How was your week, man?
Very good week, man. Very productive as usual with Block Band, just trying to be blessing people. We've been moving out lots of we've been delivering shoes and spats and gloves and music all over the country right now. So
we're just trying to do the best we can to help out as many band programs as we can.
Well, hey, man, that's outstanding, and we love what you do, and, you know, we're honored to have you on. But let's go ahead and read the winner, or the results, I should say, from the 2014 People's Choice Awards for the 90 Degree Show Week 1. I'll go ahead and add a little suspense, if you will. All right. So looking at the tabulation here, with 61% of the vote, 61% of the vote, that is, Alabama A&M edges out North Carolina A&T. So we want to congratulate Alabama A&M for winning. You know, it was really, really good that, you know, we talked about this week. You know, like we said, you know, we could only go on our expertise or what we've seen over and over this year with the MEAC SWAC challenge, but I'm really glad we got to see the tape. Shout out to you, OJ, Otis Jefferson. Shout out to you, man, and all the things you're doing and providing the good HBCU videography. Shout out to all of you guys for all of the things you do. But yeah, he put it up there, and it was funny, man. He posted it like while we were on the air. And then, you know, as soon as, like, we got off the air, you know, I fed my kids and everything and went on, it was all there for me to check out. So I've watched them all this week. And we'll definitely get back into the MEAC SWAC. I don't want to talk about it. We want to give our matchup this week its due. We want to get into Elizabeth City versus North Carolina Central, and we have Rashad now here, so we can now bounce things off of you in the first segment. So it's good to have you on, brother. Again, also, too, if you're in the chat room, if you want to leave your comments, I see a couple, some of you guys already in there, if you want to leave your comments and say, you know, what went down or whatever, I'll read those comments there on the air. So I'll get into it as far as about Elizabeth City and North Carolina Central. I picked this matchup because I was excited to hear our friend of the network, T.D. Hollins, is DeLean, as we used to call him. He is the director there, and really excited for him and his career. He's had some really good jobs, and just really proud of him, man. That, like, me and him came in together, scared, knobby need white shirts in the program together. But it's really good to see him. And then, of course, Elizabeth City is the bomb. I'm really excited to see them. I believe they're the husband-wife combo director. Is that right, Rashad, at Elizabeth City?
Yes, it is. That is correct.
Okay, so and they have been doing their thing. Yes, really excited about Elizabeth City. So I just figured, I was like, it's natural for them to meet up. And I saw Elizabeth City at the Charlotte Battle of the Bands. Now, I don't even know if this matchup actually went down. Do we know, you know, Rashad, if Elizabeth City and the actual battle between these two happened?
I don't know anything, man. It doesn't seem like anybody went to the game at all. Or if they did, they just, you know, I'm not posting it. I'm not posting this.
Right.
I mean, I can't find anything.
And, you know, and you and I talked about this a little bit about North Carolina Central. But, you know, the first thing that made me think about them was some years back when I met Christine Katzman from Halftime Mag. They had an article about the former director that was there and, you know, talking about the hybrid style and the things that they were doing. So I was excited that he actually made that type of, you know, interview. But last year, seeing the tape of them, I'm not going to say I wasn't impressed. But just say there was a lot to be like, what's going on at North Carolina Central? I mean, did you see them some last year, Rashad?
You say last year?
Yeah, last year. Did you see any tapes of them, or do you know anything that's been going on? I mean, previous to DeLean being there now, do you know anything that's going on there at North Carolina Central?
I saw them in person at the Adrian Carroll Battle of the Bands there. And, yes, it was a very poor showing for them, unfortunately. Oh, my gosh, it was unfortunate because, you know, generally after, like, a big battle of the bands, a high school battle of the bands, but there were three colleges in attendance. Elizabeth City State was there, and after the game was over, they packed up and left immediately. And A&T was there, and A&T, I think, did they play one or two songs, I think? And then they packed up. And so North Carolina Central was still there. Well, when North Carolina Central was playing, I'm not trying to hate. I'm just telling you what happened. Okay. When North Carolina Central was playing, all the high school bands left. And they blocked up, about two or three of them blocked up outside and started battling against each other. They really did not have any interest in staying and listening to them.
Wow.
And I say that because, you know, we all, those in North Carolina know, if A&T had decided to play six or seven songs, there wouldn't have been any high school bands playing.
Mm-hmm.
They would have all been camped out right there in front of A&T until A&T got done. You know, so it was a really, the field show, they had to follow A&T, which at that time was much, much bigger than they were. And it just was not a good showing. And it was unfortunate, being that, you know, a lot of us remember North Carolina Central not long ago, when they were approaching about 200 people in a band and
right.
Really were doing great performances. They were still relatively new in the MEAC. It was a pleasure to have another competitive band. I really thought that North Carolina Central, being one of the major differences in the MEAC and the SWAC is that a lot of the MEAC bands don't seat each other because they're kind of spread out. So having another band in North Carolina we thought was going to make a difference, but it hasn't. Recently, it hasn't worked out. I understand there's some things about support. It's kind of, as I understand it, it's kind of a two-way dead-end street because the administration didn't seem like they were really giving the band program the support it needed. At the same time, the administration was taking a lot of control over things that they didn't need to take control over. But yet, all that being said, blaming the band director for the band being so small.
Mm.
This is what I understand.
Wow. You know, it's funny you say that because that's very similar to the word on the street, as they say, what happened at Johnson C. Smith. You know, there was, you know, the little Cold War going on there, and, you know, he really wanted to build the band program, Mr. Gray, and, you know, there was, you know, reportedly resistance from, you know, the administration and, of course, I can't remember how it all went down, but I know that there's a new administrator there, and excuse me, he's not really tripping off the band at all. So then, you know, we may notice Smith as far as, you know, I'm not hoping that this happens, but, you know, I guess this is what, you know, we have to deal with. I know that DeLynn is talented. You know, any Mr. Adams disciple is going to do a good job anywhere, I believe. So I hope that they turn it around. But definitely this was intriguing to me. But, you know, we didn't see too much tape. I also remember when last year talking to Director Hollins, he was saying, you know, some of the stuff about putting things on the web when he was at St. Aug, you know, they didn't put too much on the web towards the end of the year because, you know, they just didn't want too many folks to see their show or what they were doing. I don't know if they've implemented that there at Central. But, you know, it's just sad we didn't get to see him. I was excited about seeing this. But I'm sure next year we'll see it. And, you know, like we say, we hope that, you know, he'll do a good job there at Central and bring them back to where what we know them to be. You know what I mean? But I did see Elizabeth City at the Charlotte Battle of the Bands. And I think I'm a fan. I just think I'm a fan of small bands that are complete and have a good sound, and they got the heart, you know what I'm saying, like your Miles and those type of schools, you know, your Savannah States or whatever. So I was really excited to see them, and shout out to, I think it was Killer Care Productions, the video that I saw. I wish it was from up top so we could see all the formations, but I still heard the band, and I felt that they were complete. And no one outplayed anyone, or, you know, they had a good sound to start off the season with, and got to see people marching and whatnot. They had a good dance routine. They had a good show. And I think that I'm excited for the CIAA. With them and Livingstone and Winston, it definitely makes the conference more interesting. And I hope that it seems like I can never see Elizabeth City versus Livingstone. What's up with that matchup? Does that matchup ever – I see the football teams play, But do the bands ever play? It's hard to find that fifth quarter or that type of tape at all.
I don't know. That's a good question. I would imagine that they probably do play. But the thing I think you got to keep in mind is that neither – these two bands both started being good. Like, right – well, I think Livingstone has been good for about 3 years. I remember the
– Right, right.
So, you know, there was probably plenty of the video of them out there that you didn't want to see. And Elizabeth City State has been bothering, right. has been starting out being pretty good probably as of last year. You know, mm-hmm. so probably a lot of stuff you were just like, I ain't watching this.
Right. Or ain't nobody going to tape it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that's what's up. I definitely did that. I know that you were there at Elizabeth City. What did you think? Or I mean, at the Queen City Battle of the Band. What did you think about Elizabeth City?
I wasn't there, actually, but I'm actually checking them out anytime that you are not talking.
Oh, you said, okay, I thought that you said that you went. I think I'm confusing you with somebody else. I know it's somebody else. Well, if you went to the Queen City Battle of the Bands, are you the strong Elizabeth City folks out there? You can call us at 718-664-6025. Or if you folks from Central out there, representing, if you've seen the band or if anybody's seen anything between these two, you definitely can let us know. I wouldn't dare say between these two right now who I would think win, because I really want to see what DeLand puts out there. But I think that was more of the case, like, you know, like what's going on with Central, you know what I mean? It hit where, you know, you already got, you know, a good rivalry there in the state. And then I always thought that, like, A&T and Central had, like a little in-state rivalry type of thing. But I guess, it's just kind of lopsided in that direction right now.
It started going to a pretty good rivalry there for a second. For years, North Carolina A&T has always overshadowed Central as to that not really being a rivalry at all. You know,
okay.
But in those couple of years, you know, recently under Mr. Reed, you know, the band had gotten pretty good there, so it was starting to turn into something. But then, you know, who knows? Hopefully, maybe it'll be something again. But as I'm checking out Elizabeth City now, I can give you some words on kind of what I'm feeling about them right now. Whenever you're ready.
Okay. Yeah. Go ahead.
Well, number one thing I would say about Elizabeth City right now is their number word phrase is consistency. It is consistency. And when I mean that, I mean a lack of consistency. When I watch them, there are some times when I say, wow, that sounds really good. Like I'm listening to their opening fanfare. It's like, wow, that's a really balanced sound. Everything I talked about last week, the attacks, the sustains, the releases, wow, that sounds really good. But then I have to kind of fast forward a little bit in order to get any in. And then I'm watching the drill, and I'm like, I'm looking at the marching, and it's like, the marching is not really. The marching, when they're standing still facing you, it's pretty good. But when they're doing their formations and things, it's not really good at all.
Yeah.
And the sound,
yeah.
Just marching around, is not really good at all. But when they turn and face you, it's like, oh, okay, look, that sounds good. And then it sounds good for a second, and then it'll kind of go away for a second. So it's like, it's kind of like listening to your favorite song while you're driving through the mountains. You're like, wait, hold up. You change it to the next station real quick. Maybe it went there. You know, I mean, but I think that I think based on what I'm hearing, when they are consistent, I think they're really building something there, and I think there will be a time where you know, MEAC bands who might face them one day would not want to sleep on it. Well, larger MEAC bands, because right now the top half of MEAC is not doing very well. But the larger MEAC bands definitely would not want to sleep on Elizabeth City State, because I think they're going to turn into something pretty good.
Yeah, I was attributing a lot of the marching I saw to just the angle. He was kind of like on, I felt like the where he was only showing like a particular squad or a couple of particular squads, and I don't want to judge them on the people that I saw in those squads. I'll leave it at that, but I'm sure, like, the people on the wings, a lot more of those saxophone squads you know, more people we could see from up top. I'm sure that, you know, they were marching pretty hard. But yeah, I saw, like, when you said, we always assume the saxophone. That's just like stereotype. You know what I'm saying? Saxophone.
That's why
you
have saxophones in your band. Like, well, I need some people. I can't just have a bunch of people playing. I need some marching, dancing.
So yeah, I was attributing that to what I saw. But yeah, I know what you're talking about. I thought it was kind of specific. But yeah, I get, you know, we can't necessarily say who would, you know, take the W or the L with this one. But of course, Elizabeth City, like you said, we both believe you're building on something, and, you know, shout out to North Carolina Central, shout out to you out there, T.D. Hollins, you know, we trust you, and, you know, we give you much success, much luck, much support here in the future. Go ahead.
That Elizabeth City, they would have taken that today. I just don't think that, based on what was happening last year at Central, could turn around that fast. I think it will, but I don't think they could have turned it around that fast versus, you know, Elizabeth City's got momentum. They've already played, you know, a game. They already went to the Battle of the Bands and had a chance to see other bands and things. Whereas, was Central there? I think they were supposed to be there. But anyway, Elizabeth City State got that momentum right now, so I think they would have taken the yesterday.
That's actually a really good assessment. They're probably, you know, dead on. So we'll definitely go ahead and take that. Let's go ahead and run through our next commercial break, and we will come right back and talk about our second matchup of the night, Tuskeegee versus Alabama A&M. And also in the next segment, we'll also talk about the MEAC SWAC challenge from last week with North Carolina A&T and Alabama A&M. So, again, thanks for listening. Thanks for all the people who are in the chat room. And wherever you are, this is a 90 Degree Show brought to you by the Marching Podcast and Blog Talk Radio.
Hey, this is John Pickens, CEO and founder of Simply Dope Creative. And you're listening to the 90 Degree Show here on the Marching Podcast Network.
Chopping It Up is a podcast of one-on-one interviews with positive role models that have a connection through music and or education. Chopping It Up is all about inspiring our youth for a great future and providing a roadmap on how to get there. We also chop it up to give insight to anyone looking for information or hope in their endeavors. Chop it up with us on Tuesday at 9 p.m. Eastern at blogtalkradio.com/marchingpodcast. Chopping It Up, changing the world through positive interaction.
Fan directors, have you ever found yourselves in this situation? Showtime is quickly approaching. Your budget is quickly disappearing. Your music choices are narrowing. The equipment condition is wearing and your stress level is mounting. Stop what you're doing and contact Block Band Music and find out how we've got you. Check www.blockbandmusic.com. Providing music, equipment, gear, and accessories to show style, core style, and traditional bands worldwide.
Hey, this is Melita Wilson, alumni of Bethune-Cookman University in Daytona Beach, Florida, founder of HBCU Campus Tours, listening to the 90 Degree Show here on the Marching Podcast Network.
Welcome to the second segment, or Block B, as they say. You're listening to North Carolina A&T from the MEAC SWAC Challenge last weekend. They are getting crunk on something, And we appreciate all the Aggie love that we have. A lot of good Aggies, friends of the program, a lot of good people that we've talked to. So we always excited to have you guys on. But let's go ahead and get into our next segment. I'll bring Rashad back in, and we'll talk here about what we saw from Tuskeegee and Alabama A&M. Go ahead and turn that off there. But Tuskeegee and Alabama A&M, I thought, again, this was another intriguing matchup. Of course, I'm like a new Alabama A&M fan from last year, really over the last like year and a half or so, but also another friend of the network starting to grow a little bit here, John Lennard, one of the first folks on the fifth quarter and really good friend of the network now. He's one of the assistant directors there at Tuskeegee University. So I want to go ahead and give him a shout out right here. When we did the interview and the chopping up interview, he was a self-made musician or a self-employed musician. That's what it's called. And I know that he said that he had was teaching before, or, you know, he took a break, or I think, you know, something happened or what went out. But by the time, you know, we launched and broadcast his Chopping Up episode, he had a job there at, you know, Tuskeegee. So like they say, God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. So it's really cool that he got that opportunity. So he's one of the assistant directors. So it's like, hey, this is an intriguing matchup now. So that's how I picked these two schools, and I was really excited to see it. I didn't see the halftime show, but I did see the fifth quarter battle. And just let me say, I wanted to see the halftime show because, you know, that's usually like the equalizer performance. You know, you can usually go out and put on a really, really good show no matter who you are or your size and win the crowd, as they say, and, you know, get enough people to say that you gave someone an L. But in the stands, it's much harder to do, you know. But, you know, when I saw the competition, it wasn't that – I wasn't too far into the video, and I hate to say it, but it wasn't even close. I think that Tuskeegee's smaller, and they just don't have the instrumentation to compete with Alabama A&M. Tuskeegee's, like, very horn-heavy. I guess that's their instrumentation, but I think that they have really, really good energy in the stands, and I like their rendition of PYT, Pretty Young Thing, from Michael Jackson. The players are holding their own there at Tuskeegee, and they don't have a bad sound, just like I said, just kind of young-sounding, horn-heavy. You could tell when they were getting fatigued, conditioning. You know, of course, it's early in the year. But then, of course, Alabama A&M, listening to them on the other side, you know, they're not there either as far as their sound. I think they're still kind of bright sounding, not as dark as I would like them to be. But they're coming for people already. I was a big fan. I'm a big fan of the Curtis Mayfield Giving You Love. Y'all check that out. That's the bomb. I saw Alabama A&M on the AAMU band subscription there on YouTube. But they cranking that Curtis Mayfield. I think that's one of the nominations for the songs of the year. And just really good power and volume. Like it's not super, super powerful or super, super loud, but just really good volume early on in this part of the season. So, Rashad, man, did you get a chance to check out the fifth quarter battle between Tuskeegee, Alabama, and A&M?
Man, you took the words right out of my mouth, man. I swear I became Professor X for a second. I just said, Joe, I want you to say this. Particularly what you were saying about A&M being sounding very bright. And I was thinking that exact same thing. It's like A&M really has a good sound. I don't understand why they sound so – I don't think I use that word bright, but that is the best term to describe it. They just don't have a dark sound that you would expect from a band that pays that much attention to detail. And I'm going to get back to that in a second. But definitely, if the fifth quarter battle is any indication of what happened at the halftime, it was a drag in the mud. I'm just sorry. I'm just sorry it just was. A&M really played circles around Tuskeegee. You could tell, and I wouldn't even say go so far as to say it's the instrumentation. Because once again, going back to Elizabeth City State, I think their sound is very similar to A&M. You know, besides the consistency factor, when they're at their best, I think they sound just like A&M, personally.
Okay.
So I think a small band can have that same type of tone quality, but it's attention to detail. You notice there's not the level of articulation that's happening. There's not the attention to the intonation as much, which is Tuskeegee as it is with A&M. So particularly, like, when I'm listening to, what's the name of that song?
Black and Blues. Yeah.
Okay, come on now. This is Black and Blues. I'm pretty sure this is a song that you guys have probably been playing for a long time. And this is a standard song in your repertoire, and you probably go through this song at least 2 to 3 times a week.
A year.
Okay.
Or a year, a week, right.
Yeah, you're probably going through it 2 to 3 times a week. You've probably been playing it since, you know, at least the third day at band camp. For that song to not be tight, that, you know, to me that would give a clear indication that something is not, there's not enough attention that's paid to detail over there. Versus when you listen to A&M, it's like, wow, you know, they have a really good sound. It's not perfect yet, but they're getting there. You know, a lot of really good sustains and things. But, yes, their sound is very bright. It's not, you know, overblowing anything like that. It's something I haven't quite put my finger on it. I would ask the people on staff there to maybe consider the type of mouthpieces they're using for the trumpets and for their mellophones. Maybe if the mouthpieces that they're using for the trumpets are too small, they might want to go to a bigger trumpet mouthpiece. Because the low brass section, the trombones in particular, are very full. I think they have a lot. I think they have a stronger trombone section than the baritone section, which could also be attributing to the brightness of the sound. Baritones, of course, add that deepness. But maybe when the trumpets take the melody, it's a lot thinner. It's a thin sound that comes through, and I don't think it's because they're not playing. I just think it's a thin sound that is coming out of the instrument. So they might be in the mouthpieces, maybe need to work on more breathing exercises. Same thing with the mellophones. When the mellophones are playing, it sounds very trumpety, which is fine if you want to sound like Southerner Jackson, but I don't think they want to sound like Southerner Jackson. And so for the sound that I think they're trying to accomplish, I think they need to really focus in on honing that mellophone sound and making it dark.
Yeah, that's actually a really, really good point. That's why, you know, it's, hey, we love the music majors because, you know, I couldn't do it. But, yeah, definitely, you know, it was definitely that, you know, bright sound. And speak of it, you know, you talked to the directors. One of the assistant directors called in last week and remember and told us about what we're actually about to get into here in a second. But definitely, you know, if, you know, they're out there or, you know, they'll let us know. I remember one of the things he said was that I think I was saying, like, oh, you know, you guys sounded good because we were talking about, we heard him on ESPN and probably noticing the microphones or whatever. And you could tell in his voice, he was like, oh, well, you know, the sound is like, you know, that's an ongoing process. So you could even tell the directors themselves are trying to get them. They don't feel that they're 100% there either. Just, you can tell in his voice, you know what I mean? If you hear it from last week. So definitely, man. So I guess, like you said, you and Professor X, we all agree it probably wasn't really close, you know? And, you know, shout out to you, John, you're doing an excellent job. And really happy that you out there doing your thing, but you know, it's the rebuild, and it takes that time for them to get back. And then again, like I say, it's just the numbers. I think that sometimes has something to do with it because, you know, Tuskeegee back in the day was much more stronger, but I don't think, you know, in the last maybe 5 or 6 years, they haven't been, you know, like powerhouse as far as their size, what we could say with like Miles or like Talladega or anything like that. So we appreciate that. So let's go ahead and get into the MEAC SWAC from last week. I saw the halftime show, and I saw the fifth quarter. So I was excited to talk about it with you this week because, you know, we didn't get to really dive into it like we wanted to. And again, remember, and I'm horrible with names, so excuse me, brother, for not remembering your name. One of the assistant band directors for Alabama A&amp called in last week and was talking
about Mario Warren.
Yeah, Mario Warren. He was saying that it was really hot. So, of course, that has something to do with the performance. And as far as that goes, you really saw that in A&T. Like, when I saw A&T's – well, okay, let me get into it as far as a halftime show first. I could tell maybe that was maybe, like, their B show, or, like, they weren't trying to dazzle the audience. It's like they kind of flipped the switch from their, like, Honda Battle of the Bands intensity momentum to this game. You know, maybe they thought they could kind of get away with the show that they get against Alabama A&M. But it just kind of just seemed like just an okay A&T show. You know what I mean? You could just tell they kind of took parts from different, you know, different parts of their show. You know, you can tell that they have a lot that they can work with as far as what they can do. But I didn't see a lot of, like, excitement, like, dazzle you, like they come with it in these Battle of the Bands, you know what I'm saying? You can definitely tell they weren't turned up all the way, I guess, so to speak. And probably with the heat, felt like they were a little fatigued. This was a Sunday game, so I don't know if they did anything on Saturday, that previous day. So, you know, maybe that has something to do with it. You know, they weren't as precise or as accurate with their formations on the field. You know, their sound is just okay. You know, like we talked about, you know, they're definitely innovative of what's going on, but it's early in the season. But their sound right now is just okay. I noticed some phrasing in the clips I saw, but I mean, as far as their sound, I don't know. It's nothing really that's, like, really making you, like, wow. You know what I'm saying right now with A&T as far as how they sound. Now, listening to them in the fifth quarter, again, I think Alabama A&M kind of smacked them around a little bit. You know, they kind of surprised me with – I don't know. What, I mean, they surprised me with how they sound. I guess there's no more accurate description of what I could say. I'm so expecting to, like, have them blow me away with something, but I don't hear that they sound all that great right now. You know, listening to them in the fifth quarter, I was kind of – I had my face all turned up like, is that A&T? Like, are they supposed to sound like that? You know, maybe the attention is on, maybe attention is on their show, but how they sound, I don't think it was close. I thought Alabama A&M was better than them and defeated them, so to speak, in the fifth quarter. And I felt that their show on the field had a little bit more energy. Again, maybe they weren't doing anything the previous Saturday. I don't know. But I thought they sounded a little bit better. I thought they had more energy on their dance routine than North Carolina A&T. And then, of course, like I said, on the fifth, I don't think it was close. I thought that, you know, they actually outplayed them. They sounded better. And then from the tape, it looks like A&T left first, you know. So, you know, I have to give it to Alabama A&M, man. What do you think, Rashad?
Well, I'll tell you this. A&M really made me eat a whole bunch of words I said last week. I mean, I had to put hot sauce and ketchup and everything on the words, man. They made me eat all of that. Because, you know, I was really basing what I had to say based off of clips that I had seen prior to that, and mm-hmm. particularly the Alabama A&M, I think it was Friends and Family performance, which I was not very good, at least in the stands, but they did not sound like that at all. Their ability level just in about, I guess, a week and a half, 2 weeks, has increased tremendously all the way up into what you see, because the performance that they are doing against Tuskeegee is much better, again, than what they did against A&T. So I
right.
definitely applaud the A&M band for the hard work that they're pushing, and they're continuing to grow and grow. They were absolutely the better sounding band and the better marching band than A&T. I personally feel the A&T show was more. I enjoy A&T's show more, but that would be the only X in the box that I would give to A&T, because definitely fifth quarter, overall sound of the band, drill, all of that goes to A&M. I just thought that, you know, A&T show, hey, I kind of enjoy this. It's kind of cool, you know. But I'll tell you this, though. This is what I have to say about A&T. I've got a lot to say about this. Because, Joe, it is interesting what people are saying about A&T right now. And all of a sudden, I know you've seen this on the field. All of a sudden, people are coming with this whole, oh, I missed the A&T from the 96 band. Oh, the early 90s and blah, blah, blah. And I don't really like this A&T. Come on, man. This has only been since, it's only been, what, 6 months, not 8 months now since A&T was bust up. You know what I mean? Now, all of a sudden, oh, I missed the 90s band. Let me tell you something. I was in the band against the 90s band. And I can tell you this right now. The band that A&T has right now can march and play circles around that band. I know it. I know. I played their music. The music at that time was, you know, was very, very simple. But, you know, no disrespect, you know, to anybody. It's what worked for them at that time. But the things that they're playing right now are a lot more challenging, a lot more difficult. The drills that they're doing are a lot more challenging. So the band they have now is a much better band. However, there are problems right now, Joe. The problem is not with the band. The problem is, as you call it, it's the play call. It's the play call right now.
Okay.
If you think about it, if you look at the show that A&T did against, I mean, at the Queen City Battle of Bands, it was a 20-minute long show, of which, from that 20-minute show, that was far more difficult than anything I have seen by any band this year. They used, I don't think they used any of it, other than the Aguiline, you know what I mean? That was it.
Right.
It was Aguiline. Other than that, it was a completely different show. I don't understand that, because not only was it a completely different show, but also it was, from a musical perspective, it was pretty difficult as well. So I think what happened there is that, and I think we talked about this last, yes, we talked about this last week with A&T. Their challenge level was way above what they were able to play, way above it. They were trying to take a show, they were trying to do a brand new show, completely different than the show they did that was 20 minutes long and one that was pretty challenging, and take it against Alabama A&M, which is a band that has worked very good to sound good. And it just blew up in them. Trombones in particular, in that high range, that's really where nobody has pointed it out, but I think that that's where a lot of the complaints lie, is that, you know, trombones, when they get in that high range, they're very easy to get those fly positions kind of thrown off, you know, and they were there and the fly positions weren't tight. You could tell that, so therefore called the intonation problem. You could tell there was problems with knowing the music. Like, I think it was the first or the second song that A&T played in the fifth. The beginning of that song was like, what the heck happened in the song? It was like, whoa! And, you know, but I think that the band could only remember so much, you know, and I really think that the staff is going to have to really take into consideration what they have, what they're working with, and kind of not make that mistake again. On the other side of that, though, for all the people that are hating on them right now, I would say, and I might be putting my foot in my mouth again, but I'm gonna give this challenge to A&T. I expect that by the third or fourth game of this season, they're going to be dynamite again.
Yeah,
that long. Go ahead.
I was going to say, I see that as well. You know, I'm just attributing probably from what I see to just dead on what you said. They seem to have a lot of shows together, or they have like maybe, oh, this is show B or this is compartment C, so they're able to then mix, oh, this show we're going to this battle of the bands, we're going to this performance, this is the show we're going to do. So they're probably, who knows, in band camp they probably are able to put together five or six shows right there on the first day, and so maybe, you know, they're not spending as much attention to the music part, so, you know,
right,
maybe that will catch up soon later. But again, I was just, I don't expect them to sound that bad, I guess. I guess that's what I'm thinking, because, you know, they just sounded bad against Alabama A&M, and I'm just kind of, you know, and the phrasing, all of that, I just have not heard. And your comment as far as about the 96, I was there at Smith in 96, and A&T was only build. It seems that they were building. That is definitely the haterisms talking, because it seems that they have built and established what they are now from the 90s. You know what I mean? Like, it's not a question about who is better, because that the school now is much better than they were in the 90s to me. And yeah. Even when I saw A&T play Jackson State, I think it was 2001 or 2002 in Atlanta. Just think, there's a year I was the year after I graduated Jackson State. A&T, you know, Jackson State destroyed them then. It wasn't close, you know. But it was it wasn't the band that we see now. So yeah, it's just that's unfortunate that the haters had to be saying something, man. But so I guess we both agree about. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Okay, A&T back then, you know, the thing that people think about was how good are you at what you do. And the A&T back in the 90s was better at what they do than the A&T band now is at what they do. I'm talking about like right now, like this month.
Right.
But not a couple months ago. But the thing about it was that nobody thought that the A&T in 96 was like upper echelon band.
No, thank you. That's where I totally agree with you, yeah.
Yeah. Nobody said, I can't wait for it. Nobody across the nation would say, oh, I can't wait. Now, everybody enjoyed their show. They put out a good product, and they were a very powerful band, particularly for a MEAC band. But when you look at, when you compare them to the MEAC band, you would say, wow, that's powerful. Man, they're amazing. But then if you compare them to a SWAC band in the 90s, you would look at Jackson and Southern and everybody else and be like, but they're not nearly as clean as these guys are, and these guys are loud, too.
Right, exactly.
You know,
exactly.
But nowadays, you can say, yeah, A&T. Now, it's easy to say, wow, I'm disappointed in A&T, because everybody now feels that A&T is definitely an upper echelon band.
It's a trip, man. Like, no matter what goes on or what's being said, you can't never, you know what I'm saying? You can't never, ever, let's say, like, please someone or tell someone that, you know what I'm saying, that everything was right. Like, it seemed like everyone cannot agree. Sorry, I thought somebody was knocking on my door, man. You can't never all agree on all the same thing, you know, no matter how, if it was the greatest. And we're going to talk about that in the next segment. You know, someone always has to say, oh, I don't think it was all of that. You know what I'm saying? I guess that's my point. You know what I mean? It's always someone saying, oh, it ain't all that. You know what I'm saying? Moving on, yeah, I'm about to see who's still here at my door. Let's go ahead and go to the next commercial break, and we'll go ahead and keep that moving. In this last commercial break, we'll talk about any potential barn burners we may see, word on the street. And there was a discussion on the 5th about Southern and Bohemian Rhapsody I wanted to talk to you about. So we'll go ahead and get to the last segment here of the 90 Degree Show, brought to you by The Marching Podcast and Blog Talk Radio. Thanks for listening.
Hi, this is Thaddeus Dixon, Crab of 94 on the Sonic Boom of the South, graduate of Jackson State University, class of 2000, and you are listening to the 90 Degrees Show at the Marching Podcast Network.
From photo shoots to graduation pictures, from probates to band footage, from pageants to yard shows, there's only one team you can count on, the Edgemont Productions. Visit theedgemont.com, and trust me, you won't be disappointed.
What if there was a Facebook for bands? Wait a minute, there is. Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org is a social network for HBCU show bands. You can create your own profile and post videos, photos, and comments on Bandhead.org. Need somewhere to post events, audition schedules, job postings? Check out Bandhead.org. Are you recruiting for talent? Go to Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org, a social network for bands. Having an anniversary party, birthday party, or better yet, are you about to marry that special someone? Liquid Effects Photography is the perfect choice to immortalize all your most special moments. With 10 years of dependable professional service that can deliver from the conventional to the best in cutting-edge technology and creativity, come experience the uniqueness of Liquid Effects Photography. We serve the entire Upper Midwest and will travel further upon request. Come check us out at liquideffects.com. That's LIQUIDEFFEX.com. Or call us at 773-454-5556. That's 773-454-5556.
Hi, this is Chris Jones, owner and founder and creator of March Aerobics. My website is cj@marcharobics.com. And you listen to the 90 Degree Show and the Marching Podcast Network. Now get your legs up.
I need to unmute my microphone so people can hear me. We're back here. You are listening to Elizabeth City State University at the Queen City Battle of the Band, their performance that you're listening to now. We're in the final segment of the show in the last couple of minutes, and we appreciate all those listening, all those people who were here with us from beginning to the end, and again, all those people who are listening in podcast form. If you are interested in becoming a sponsor or a patron to the Marching Podcast Network, please contact the show and we'll give you the criteria so we can start to pub your business using our platform. We'll play your commercial, we'll post your website on our blog, and we'll help send out your information through social media. So contact us so we can help to build your business. All right, so, and right quick, yeah, that was the person next door. I am all good. Ain't nobody else trying to get in here. But they did throw off my concentration for what I was trying to say, Rashard. But basically that was just that, you know, I guess you can't fool all of the people all the time. You can fool some of the people some of the time, but you can't fool all the people all the time. And that's actually a good segue into this final segment as far as word on the street and comments and things that we saw from the fifth quarter. I got the fifth quarter open, and one of the things that interests me was, of course, Southern University. I'll put it out there, and shouts out to you, Garrett Edgerson, the edge1.com. Another friend of the network. But talking about them, they've played Bohemian Rhapsody. Now, Southern, just like when we talked on our award show, they always seem to be playing one of the potential songs of the year, or they always be throwing something out at us where we're all talking about it. And they've played Bohemian Rhapsody this year, and to a lot of praise, a lot of thumbs up from a lot of folks. But, of course, there's always one or two people that's like, oh, I don't understand what's going on. What's so special about this, man? I don't like this, man. You know what I'm saying? It's always something. But I wanted to get your take. What do you think? Have you heard Southern play the Bohemian Rhapsody this year?
Absolutely, definitely. And they have gotten applause not just from HBCU fans, but actually from Sports Illustrated and from Fox, NFL. I mean, it's pretty amazing that they've been recognized like that on these different websites. It seems like they all have the same video as well. I thought that's interesting.
You said that they have the same videos as well?
Yeah, they all have this. Everybody's got the same video of Southern playing it. So it makes me wonder if one of our guys, you know, one of the HBCU guys, you know, the Edge one and, you know, Martin 8 to 5, they got it, and then everybody else has gotten a hold to it, or was it, you know, somebody from the from the networks that recorded that?
Right. I enjoy it. I think it was really cool. I know one person, SU guard, or Sugrad 11, I'm not sure how you say his name, but he commented on the fifth quarter. It was a great clip. OMG, you had to be at this game in person to hear the pure power of this song. Hamer will definitely take this band to even greater heights. By the way, the two new arrangers are coming for Blood. So it looks like, you know, not only did people really enjoy it over the clips, but it looks like there's even more power to be witnessed if you were there actually there at the game to check out for Southern. So That's what's up with them. But I also saw some stuff on the 5th, and in fact, someone, the Thoughts, shout out to the Thoughts out there in the chat room. He said, you know, no ASU, TSU talk. And I know that we touched base on this today because a guy screaming trumpet on the 5th, he actually put his whole assessment of the Bama State, Tennessee State battle up on the 5th. And I just got to at least give him props and give him a shout out to what I saw there on the 5th.
This screaming trumpetalysis.
Yeah, man, I really liked, I mean, I just really liked that. But it's just seeing that, and just like with you and the prunalysis, you know, these people are actually putting it down as far as, you know, what we're able to see. And I enjoy reading stuff like that. You know, I enjoy hearing people talk about it. So the Thoughts, you know, I didn't get a chance to see the game because we were preparing for the other games, and we were hoping that, you know, Tuskeegee or something else we would pop up and see. But we didn't get a chance to see it. But I hear that Bama State, based on what the Screaming Trumpet brother was saying, he was saying that Bama State sounded better than Tennessee State, and that old monkey on Tennessee State back, that they was just bland, that they were just really good, you know, really good marching, just really good sounding, but just kind of bland and just out there. You know, we kind of hear this thing being repeated about Tennessee State. Did you get a chance to see the guy, his thing on the 5th and what he was saying?
I didn't. I watched a little bit of what we could find of the, you know, of the halftime show. The TV coverage was really bad, you know, so you couldn't really hear them. And I did see, you know, a good portion of A&M's show. I'll believe it when I see it, when you say that, when people say that Bama State sounded better than Tennessee State. I will believe that when I see it, because Bama State, to me, I really just started getting into Bama State as of last year, because now, you know, I can really see the clear difference between the State and the A&M. And I always think that Bama State is like that. It's like the stepsister. No offense to stepsister. You know, but it's like the stepsister of Jackson and Southern. It's like Jackson and Southern are great, really powerful bands, but they're really precise. With Alabama, or they can be really precise. Versus A&M, they're also a really, really powerful band, but they don't capitalize on the precision and the attacks as much as those other two. So to say
Bama State
as good, huh?
You mean Bama State? I know I get them mixed up too. Yeah, I say that too.
Bama State doesn't really pay attention, in my experience, to attacks and releases and all those type of things as much as particularly Jackson State. You know, Southern does. They have their points where things can go wild, but particularly Jackson State. And Tennessee State and Jackson are kind of all neck and neck as far as playing ability and musicality. So to say that Bama State sounded better, that's hard to say. But I can definitely believe that they had a better show. I may have missed my cue there, Joe, if you wanted me to say more about the Bohemian Rhapsody. I was just saying
I
saw it.
I was just touching base on, you know, just because I saw the clock and I wanted to make sure you know, we got out in good time. The Thoughts just posted I think he posted here a link here, and this is probably the, it looks like TSU, Good Kisser. This is what he sent to me. I wish I could listen to it now, but it would pick up on the radio. So I'll check this out and let him know what I think. But it looks like he's saying TSU. He gives it to TSU. And the guy on the Screaming Trumpet, he thought that the halftime went to Tennessee State. Neither halftime was spectacular, but Tennessee State came with a lot of flash as a big band. I did not get to see the sound I was expecting, but they executed well, which is what I was, again, talking about. That's what we always hear about Tennessee State, that they're just bland. He says that Bama State's halftime was blah, but, of course, the Honeybeans got house for their big girl routine, which it seemed like that's the ace in the hole. Throw some big girls out there, you'll be scrism out here. That's kind of sad. It's kind of bumming me out a little bit. But thanks to the Thoughts, man, for you know, for your help and for your comments. I know that that was one thing that we wanted to touch base on. We just didn't see. We didn't have time to check out that game. But please, Rashad, go ahead and go into more about the Bohemian Rhapsody. We got a couple minutes here before we close out.
All right, good stuff. Well, as you've been saying, there are haters out there. You know, I didn't want to fall into that boat myself. So let me get this out of the way starting out so that I can start bad and then end on a very, very positive. First
okay.
of all, baritones and mellophones. I'm holding my hands up right now. Like, what are y'all doing? Like, seriously, what are y'all doing? Because there's so many points in there where I'm thinking about it, like, listening to this song from everybody's perspective. Like, you know, let's say drum and bugle corps person listening to this song. And they're saying, wow, that sounds really good. Until baritones and mellophones hit, they hit some really off notes in there. Mm. I'm like, come on, guys. Like, come on. There's way too much musicality going on in this song for you guys to be way off pitch on some of the things that y'all are doing. When they're playing with the whole band, it sounds great. But when they're having those opportunities to stand out, they're really focusing. And particularly mellophones are selling. It's something I've been saying over and over and over again. Hopefully somebody will listen to them. Please. Make them listen. However, the overall band, overall, it was a fantastic performance. I really have to give tremendous props to their trombones. They actually had a melody. It's like the only melody in a song they have this year. But they sound amazing. I mean, they really sounded it. Mama, I'm just human.
Right.
Particularly when they went to those high notes, which, as I was just talking about with A&T, it gets tricky in that high range. And yet they pulled that off flawlessly. Great job. And then the trumpets, Joe, man, when it,
yeah.
When they hit those high notes in that chord like that, that's amazing. There's probably a handful of bands in the nation of any kind.
That can do that. Yep.
That can do that. Chorus included. I mean, it was clean. And just to be able to hit it in that chord and to be that high like that and it sound that good, I have to give them tremendous props. So I really thought it was good. As far as the choice of the song, I don't personally think it was anything that was, how should I say, completely out of the box, per se, simply because I think due to Wayne's World, a lot of people know that. A lot of people know that song, you know.
Right.
People in our generation, because of Wayne's World, we know that song. And so I don't think it would be out of character for any show-style band to play that. But I'm glad that they did play it, and I think they did a really, really good job overall.
You know, and that kind of, and right before we close out of the show, I kind of wanted to ask you about that. That was what someone said, and maybe they're just talking out of their, you know what, but, you know, they were talking about how people nowadays are they, and, you know, I don't know who they is, but, that's thinking out of the box when HBCUs play something from a white artist. Do you believe that? I personally don't. I don't know where that came from. And I don't think that's thinking out of the box. How do you feel about that before we close out for the show tonight?
Yeah, it can be, but HBCU bands, as far as I know, have always done that. A lot of the best songs that people know have been songs by white artists, such as A&T's number one drill, one of the number one drill songs back from the 90s. For all the 90s fans of Easy Lover, which is Paul Collins, is it Collins?
Phil Collins.
Collins. Whatever it's like. Phil Collins, that's it. You
the
know,
drummer.
I mean,
yeah.
Yeah. And they would drill that all day long back in the 90s, you know, everybody's favorite, you know, version of A&T. You know?
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't think that's that unusual.
Well, that's what's up, man. Rashad, we really appreciate you again. Another successful show. I really think this format works a whole lot better where you and I talk from beginning to the end. It's really cool bouncing things off of you. So I definitely think we'll keep it like this. And again, for all the people who are listening, you can call in at 718-664-6025 or join our chat room just like as the other people. And shout out to you, the thoughts. For commenting and leaving the clip for me to check out Tennessee State, and I'm sure that that will be coming up on the end. So, Rashad, I'm going to go ahead and sign you off. You got anything else to say before we sign off for tonight?
Yeah, shout out to your neighbor as well, man. I hope your dog didn't bite his or his dog bite yours. I hope there's no property disputes.
Yeah, man, a little scrubby little kids next door, man.
I hope there won't be a new host
of the show next week. Oh, no. Little scrubby little kids playing around, probably throwing some rocks or something like that over there. You know what I'm saying? But yeah, I thought it was somebody knocking on the door. You know, I was like, oh, snap, somebody trying to get in the window while I'm in here on the podcast. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, that's all good. You know, hey, you know we out here on the west side. You know, we got to protect ourselves, man.
Right.
That's what's up, man. Well, thanks again, Rashad. I'll holler at you next week, man.
No problem, man.
All right, well, thanks. That's all the time we have for the show tonight. Check out our website at themarchingpodcast.com and donate what's in your heart. Check, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter. Thanks to you for listening. And remember, the lectures you may deliver may be very fine and true, but I'd rather get my lessons by observing what you do. See you next time.
Wide on the rest of it.